What's up, man?
Hey, how you doing, dude?
How's it going?
It's good. Everything's good.
Good. I seen you around before, man. Down by the stage or during the summer.
Oh, you mean Division Street?
Yes.
Stage?
Yeah.
Yep. My name's Jack. I'm the general manager here at Somerville School of Rock, and I'm always there in the summer because sometimes we do sound for the town.
Okay.
Or our school plays, or I also do like a lot of flag days we've done before for the, you know, for the school. So that's why you probably see me in the area a lot.
Okay, how did you become involved with the School of Rock?
Let me see. Well, I would say 9 years ago. I've been a touring musician since I'm 19. Someone told me, hey, you should go into teaching because I know you love kids and you love the show about music and stuff. But what happened was about 9 years ago, somebody told me about School of Rock because I saw the movie with Jack Black and blah, blah, blah. And what happened was, I worked in Mattawan. I went to Mattawan, and they really liked me. They had a small School of Rock there, and I started there. And then corporate got a hold of me and said, you, with your history, you'd probably be a really good teacher up in Tenafly. So that was like the big corporate school. So I went up there, and I taught there for like a year and a half. And the commute got kind of crazy for me because it's pretty far. So what happened was, a friend of mine owned this school, and they called me up. They said, you should come in here and check out our school. And that was 8 years ago.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so I started as a teacher, and then I moved up to a music director running shows. And now I've been the general manager and the music director here for over 2 years now.
So how did you get into being a teacher?
Well, you know, what happened was when I was growing up, and I gotta say this, no disrespect to anybody that I took lessons from, they never taught me what I really wanted to learn. It was kind of a weird thing. Like my dad was a Jersey City police officer, and I told him I wanted to be a musician more than anything in the world. And he was cool with me. Like you would think, oh, your dad's a cop, probably not really into you doing that. But he took me for lessons, and most of my lessons that I remember being like 12 and 13, they were really not that good because all the teachers did were, here, I'll teach you a song, but never taught me the theory and why I'm learning the song. You know what I mean? It was just more like, hey, you wanna learn Led Zeppelin? You wanna learn Black Sabbath? I'll teach it to you, but I'm not gonna show you the scales. And that really bothered me. So I think later on in life, as I got more into music, as I went to GIT and all this stuff, I always said, bro, if I'm not torn, I would love to bring something back to the kids. And that's kind of where it happened for me.
Gotcha.
Like I took my bad experiences and then my good experiences and tried to bring it all and teach. That's kind of how it really happened for me.
Good. So take a, okay, pause.
So far, so good?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, good, good. My arm just gets a little tired. Okay. What was your first experience with music in general? Like, were you a piano player?
That's easy. I was in 7th grade, and I'm 50 now, so I'm proud of it too. So I'm like, oh, I'm 50. I was in 7th grade, and a Broadway play called Cats was huge.
Yeah.
So my music teacher was really cool and really liked me, and my dad bought me this really cool Strat, big Fender, my first real cool guitar. And we did a Broadway 7th grade show, and we were putting makeup on like Cats and everything. I was a big Kiss fan, and our teacher said, why don't we put a band behind it like you were having Broadway? And that's kind of my first real experience. We put on the Cat show, and I got to be like the guitar player in the show. So that was kind of like my first, and once I did that,
hooked.
It was
over. Yeah, that's.
My dad looked at me and he's like, and I love sports and everything.
Sure.
I was totally into sports. And I guess my dad was hoping that I would have followed his first steps on my grandfather's and become a cop.
And did not. Just, yeah.
It, but you know what, man? It. My dad was one of my biggest, my mom and my dad were so supportive of me. I was young.
Yeah.
And I must have did something right because I was 15 years old playing at 21-year-old clubs. My dad would drive me to the gigs and wait while I played.
Awesome.
So, yeah, it was, I was pretty, like, that's where another thing I bring back too.
Sure, like, absolutely.
You know, I tell the kids that, I tell the parents too, like, you know, my parents had my back. Like, you know, music's like, man, it kept me off the street. And I tell these kids too, it takes you away from all the bad things in the world.
Absolutely,
you know?
Sure, give you something to do. Do you still, is the guitar have dust on it, or are you still playing, or?
I'm still touring. I just got back. I play guitar now for a gentleman named John Beauvoir. John was the original bass player in the Plasmatics, and then he went on to writing for all the Ramones. He was Little Steven's bass player from Bruce Springsteen's band, and he's written 13 Kiss songs. He wrote the Cobra soundtrack, so I'm his touring guitar player now. But before that, I'm one of the most fortunate musicians in the world. I was in one of my favorite bands called Sabotage, which became Trans-Siberian Orchestra. So I played in that band. I play guitar from Joey Belladonna from Anthrax. I have my own band called Seven Witches. I have 53 records to my name.
Wow.
So from 19 years old, I started the tour of the world. And to now, I'm still touring the world.
Wow.
I am like, I will say this, man, I am the most fortunate guy in the world.
It sounds pretty cool to me.
I mean, yeah, and is my guitar dusty? No.
No.
It's still my favorite thing to do.
Yeah, guitar.
When I have a bad day, I pick up my guitar, and I love it.
Now, do you play piano? Do you play anything?
I play a little piano. Yep. I play bass, I play guitar, and I'm a producer. I have a full studio at the school where I can record bands.
Awesome.
So I have another side, too, that I can record besides teaching.
Awesome. So now you're going to grab a coffee. We'll talk about the school on the way back. Let's go. So what'd you get?
This is the big joke. Since I'm addicted to Starbucks, I come here every day and they made my own drink now. It's called a Jackadoodle.
Oh, man.
They're really nice.
What is it? Is it what's in a Jackadoodle?
Oh, it's cinnamon dolch, white chocolate mocha, but all sugar-free because I'm a health nut, skim milk, no whipped cream.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is pretty cool. Gotta love that. So the School of Rock then, I mean, people looking, what kind of people come in there? They're just looking for more lessons or starting out from scratch?
See, school, it's very special how School of Rock works. It's not like most places where it's just lessons. We teach everything, drums, bass, guitar, keyboards, vocals, banjo, whatever you need. But we also do another thing where we do shows. We have rookie programs for like 4 and 5 year olds. And they'll get together on a Saturday and work on songs, easy stuff for beginners. And then we have a one-on-one program where it could be like 9 years old up to like 13. And then we go on the seasonal shows. That could be the kids that are 13 to 18. And we even have an adult program now on Thursday nights where adults come in once a week and they work on songs. And how we do it is we have a jam room. I'll show you too if you have time. I like you to see the room and stuff. The kids get in there, we'll have like shows like Guns N' Roses versus Metallica.
Oh, that is awesome.
So they have like 3 months to learn the songs, and we have all the kids like from each, they sign up. Right now we're doing the replacements, like bands like Van Halen lost David Lee Roth, so Sammy Hagar joined the band. We're doing Queen show next season because the Queen movie was so big and how it was with School of Rock. So. It's way different, man. It's like lessons, but it's also like you don't have to go find a band. We put bands here together for you. So a 12-year-old could play with a 17-year-old, so it's really great.
It sounds like you do production then, too, also. Or
we do everything. I mean, we have summertime, we have summer camps.
Okay.
Where a whole week kids come and just jam all day long.
Wow.
You know, they could do recording. I've done a couple of recording programs here where kids come in for a week. We write songs, and then we record the songs they wrote, and they leave with a CD.
Awesome.
I mean, it's really well broad, man. It's not just like, hey, you come in for 45 minutes, take a guitar lesson, and that's it. It's literally a full music, and great thing about our school, and I have to say this, it makes me more happy than anything, yes, they learn music, yes, they learn how to play, but they become friends, and they all hang out together. It's like a family, it is. I mean, and the kids do so good. We do Balloon Fest. The kids get to play before Pat Benatar, REO Speedwagon. You know, they'll play on the flag day on top of the courthouse. I take my house band. House band is like the best players in the school. We put a band together and they learn all these songs from Styx and Kansas and REO Speedwagon. And then they open up for like national acts. They did a guitar show with Zach Wilde from Ozzy played. They just opened up for me and John. We did a warm-up show. They were our opening band, which is just cool. Yeah. So even the house band, they become our opening band. So we'll take the kids out with us, let them use our gear, let them play a real room. It's pretty great, man.
Wow. I mean, that...
And we also like, I don't know if you're familiar with a place called Roxy and Duke's. It's right in Dunellen. It's this really great bar this guy Jimmy owns. It's a great rock place. And every 3 months, the kids that work on all the songs, we have seasonal shows. So the parents and old friends come out. You get to see them play like a real rock show.
Wow.
It's pretty great.
I mean, talk about experience. Coming from you, you've been around, you've seen it all. I mean, there's really no other place to be if you want to be a musician. I mean, as far as I'm concerned.
You know what, man? I got to say this, and I always say this. And I'm not saying this because I work there. But when I was their age, I tell the kids this all the time. You know how hard it was to find kids your own age to jam with? Number one. And number two, it's... Want to go that way?
We'll just chill out here.
Okay. I mean, the thing about it is, I had to practice in my mother's dining room. And there was no room. We would set up a drum set, plug into one amp. The singer would plug into the same amp, playing guitar out of here. Everyone's here already. We have amazing gear, and they get to be a band.
Wow.
And it's really...
Plus the experience in the music industry, I imagine there's a lot to know, right? About it, especially if you get good, right?
Well, the one thing about our school is, and I have to say, my owner is a sweetheart. She lets me hire most of the people. Most of the guys that work there are my friends, and they're all seasoned touring musicians. So I think that's really cool because what they all have learned, they bring their experience to the kids. You can't buy that man on somebody on Craigslist. Hey, I give guitar lessons.
No,
you know what I mean?
Not at all.
We really try to make it.
I'll meet you inside.
It's an experience and a half.
But it's also very family owned.
Awesome.
Like the parents, you know. He may not like rock and roll. What's really interesting is like the parents come. You know, I don't know if you have kids or anything, but. You know, some people just drop off the kids at basketball practice, see you later. Here, the parents stay the whole time.
Wow.
They'll get coffee, they'll talk to like the studio coordinator, they'll talk to the teachers, they'll talk to other parents. Like, that's amazing. And they don't want to leave. Some of them are like there for 3-4 hours just hanging out while the kids are practicing.
Awesome.
So, it's pretty great.
So what, you said events, is there, do you have an upcoming event or anything? It's in winter time, but I mean, is there still?
At the place Roxy and Dukes.
Okay.
On the 19th and 20th, we're doing our big seasonal shows. So that's like the replacement show. We're doing there's like 6 shows that day, and it goes on for 2 days. The kids get to play, like I said.
Now, do you get on and play with them at all? Or?
Nah, you know, I did a few times, but it's really about them. I mean, I'm there because I run the whole day, but then all the teachers come that run their shows. It's pretty awesome, to be honest with you.
So, I don't know if we covered it in the beginning, but like, why Somerville? I mean, did we talk about that in the beginning?
No.
No. Why Somerville of all the places?
Well, I can't really speak like I me
for you. For, I mean, you're here
because I live in Hillsboro.
So proximity.
Like 8 minutes away.
Wow.
And you know, this place has got so brought up. I mean, Division Street's amazing. This reminds me of like New York and Hoboken now. It's got the vibe. Everyone's cool. So many restaurants. We rehearsed it before our tour, and we would go to Alfonso's every night, and the manager there, George, he hooked us up so much. Every night he would get us a table, and it's so different in this area. It's like you walk around here in the summertime with the car shows, and you know, they have the movies going on, and then we'll run the sound on Division Street, and all the bands play. You know, my owner child was in Princeton School of Rock, and they wanted to buy a School of Rock so bad, and this one was available, so
there you go.
That's how it happened.
There we go.
So why don't you come enter our building? I'm inviting him in now. So this is our Somerville School of Rock. Okay. This is our opening office area where, like I said, our parents hang out. This is one of our awesome students, Emily. Come on, Emily, say hi.
You want to be on? All right.
Hi.
What's going on, Emily? Jersey, I've seen you around before.
Yeah, we're very dogs, families. It's just open. And this is Janessa, our studio coordinator.
Hey, hello.
She makes everything run smooth.
Nice.
This is one of our teachers, Andy, keyboards, guitar, vocals. Andy's dad owns Dragonfly.
Okay, very good. Nice to meet you. Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
So this is one of our sitting areas. This is the pedal lounge we have. And these are some of our guitar rooms.
Okay.
For lessons, guitar and bass.
Sure.
And this is another one of our teachers, Paul. He's in the middle. This is Paul.
How you doing, Paul? What's going on?
Guitar, bass teachers, and music directors.
Very good. Hello. Okay. Sorry to interrupt.
Take you up. This is, of course, our cool bathrooms. We're kind of.
It's actually a really cool place.
One of our touring musicians. This is Tommy. He's our drum teacher.
Hey, Tommy, how's it going?
Amazing player. I take him up. This is one of our amazing teachers, Robbie.
Hello, Robbie.
One of the students doing drums. Robbie teaches keyboards, guitars, bass, vocal. He teaches it all.
Nice.
So this is like our another one of our, and we actually rehearse here too. We have a full PA and everything.
Awesome.
So
great.
Sorry, guys, I need to borrow these.
No worries at all. Good to see you.
I take you upstairs to the next.
Okay.
Area. So this is like another little lounge area. Robbie has an amazing band, and they rehearse up here and not. And this is Tommy's drum room. You know, our teachers make the rooms themselves too. Like, you know, we don't say you have to have certain things. So, you know, stuff that he's into and makes it look, you know, more like New York City, like the old days back.
Absolutely.
You know, it's very cool. As of now, this is just a storage room, but we have all our drums. We're going to make this more rehearsal rooms.
Hey, what's up, everybody?
This is one of our vocal rooms. You're smiling right now.
All right, you ready to do some singing?
Hey, one? You see one?
You get a single orders? Oh, really?
What do you got?
I'm impressed.
Let's see what we got.
You're awesome. Go for it.
Let's do a scale going up. Whole step.
So, you know, we talk about scales and stuff, the stuff that I didn't get to have when I was her age.
So, we're gonna go like that. So, ready? Good. Good pitch. Keep going up.
Great job! Great
job!
That was pretty good.
Enjoy. And this is our technically this is my room. My own room. But this is all the records I've made.
Wow!
And full recording studio here, Pro Tools, everything.
Pro Tool guy.
Yeah. Nice. Full on. And usually there's a lot more stuff in here, so it's cool. Nice. I think these are just chores I've done, records
awesome.
I've done.
This is awesome.
It's great. They're very good to me. Like, they let me, you know, imagine having your own place to record. It's
awesome.
Just, it's crazy great.
That is great. I'm an Ableton guy myself.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, I dabble, you know. Sometimes you got to throw some stuff together to get stuff.
I just moved up to 12.
Yeah?
Like, it really was hard because...
What do you think of all that? I mean, as a musician, as kind of the music
really,
you put out in the electronic world of things.
I got to tell you, I grew up on analog. Everything was real to real. But I learned how to use analog, and then we went to, you know, it wasn't technically digital. That was like more like ADATs, and then we went to like D88s, like the little tiny video camera ones. But you know, they were like big.
Yep.
It was hard. The D88s, you put like three DVDs in, for them to line up was such a hassle. I really fought this whole digital thing for a while because I felt like a lot of guys would cut out and not actually play. They'll play a part and just edit everything. I don't do that. When I record, I still go the old-fashioned way. Like, it was reel-to-reel. But, you know, it's made life easier. My bass player lives in California.
Yeah.
We send Dropbox to each other. It's amazing. But one thing I got to say that really bummed me out a little bit, I guess like a lot of manufacturers, I started on 7-8. Bought a lot, spent a lot of money on it. And then, you know, 12 is 11 and 12. I wanted to move up. You couldn't move up. So all the money you spent, you had to go and all your plugins. It's almost like, you know, like you get a phone.
I know.
I use technology. But, you know, I'll say this, and I don't care what anybody says to me about this one. If you're going to record, still record the correct way. I understand, like, you want to jump vocals because singing chorus is a lot. But if you're going to play guitar, play the song.
Yeah.
I mean, guys literally will play dun, dun, dun. And that's it. And just cut and paste.
Just loop
that.
It, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like, you know what? The first Led Zeppelin record, the first Black Sabbath record, you hear the mistakes.
But well, there's something about imperfection, not a digitally exactly mastered and an algorithm applied to it, so it sounds natural. Why not just do it natural?
Yeah, and it's like, you don't even want to use a real drummer.
Yeah.
You just use,
oh, the drum machines, yeah,
I mean,
and all that stuff.
I mean, now they're like, you know, they got a guy in the studio. My drummer plays a Type O Negative in Danzig, Johnny Kelly. He did a lot of this stuff, and they take his drum patterns and they use it. I mean, I get it. It
right.
works, but
I know. There's the whole
like,
digital world of things.
And Johnny's such a great drummer. I want to hear him play a kit. The old days, you would get in a room, and Led Zeppelin got in a room, and they jam. Nobody does it anymore. Now it's like...
They could do it here, though.
They can. And we try... When we record still, we still use real drums. We have... Yeah. Johnny goes to... We got a real studio. You know, like... Not that this is not a real studio, but we go to a big place with drums.
Right,
drums are... If you don't get a good drum sound, man, you know.
Yeah.
It's gonna hurt.
You need the kick.
I mean, I'm glad because I can do a lot more work at home.
That's awesome.
I made records in my bedroom now but you know what? These guys that feel that, you know, record labels now, here's $2,000, make a record.
Well, that's a whole nother conversation about what the world is these days with digital downloads and everything else going in.
Dude, we used to
hand out CDs or tapes.
But we still bought the record because you still want to look. I mean, look at the record. Don't you want to look how cool that is?
And the artwork and everything else is so much to
it.
The lyrics.
Yeah. You're like, well,
there's something about that.
You can see it online. I'm
yeah.
like, no, you can't.
Yeah, but that's an experience. When you went to the store and you bought it and you opened it and you folded it open and like the Tool album or whatever, and it was that the artwork was ridiculous on it.
For me, it was like, Judas Priest and Iron Maiden. Those
Iron Maiden.
The
artwork on those album covers, like Aces High or something like that. I mean, it's
like,
just...
What's Eddie going to look like this record?
Yeah, exactly.
And you know, it's funny. Like I said to you, I grew up in Jersey City. Times were different, man.
Right.
My dad would give me $10.
Right.
Back then, that's a lot of money.
It is.
And me and my friends, 13 years old, go on the PAT train, go to 8th Street, and walk around and buy... And come home at like 10
right.
LPs. And not even know the name of the bands. Just... Go, that's a cool cover.
Yeah. You look for that one hit on one thing and you got it and it gets played over and over again.
And you know, you said the digital age. Another thing with the kids here that I have a problem with, and they know I have a big problem with this. You know, we're working on a seasonal show. Don't learn a song. And I'm like, that's not right. Like, well, the guy on YouTube did it. I go, when I was your age, we had a record. You know what a record is? We had a needle. We used our ears and we put it down.
Yeah, there's something to be said about
that. That sounds like a lot of work. I'm like, and they just feel like, well, I can just go online and get Tablature.
Right.
I'm like, okay, it's a good starting point, but you still got to use your ear.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Well, it's a great place you have here, man. I really appreciate the time today. And
please.
I mean, Somerville is very fortunate to have someone like you in the neighborhood and teaching the young kids how to be musicians, man. So
awesome. Thank you, man. I love this town. Everyone is so cool. And like I said, man, this is such a great place because it's such a... And you saw it downstairs. The dog's sitting down there.
Yeah.
We're very family oriented. And that's
awesome.
How it is. You know, come in, hang out. I mean...
So how do you get, you got like a little plug, you know, just in general, how people reach out to you? You got a website and things like that?
You know, you can go on Somerville School of Rock's Facebook,
okay.
For sure. But I can give you a business card. You can take a picture of it.
Oh, yeah, that's cool.
You guys want to come down for a lesson? We always have your first lessons free.
Okay.
It's a trial. Check it out. See what you think. And if you like it, you know, you will not like it.
That's awesome.
It's amazing here. Like, kids will learn a lot. And they go home with more than just learning music. They go home with everything, like friends. it's like you said, it's an experience.
Awesome.